We look good.
Oh, look at that. We're back on the air again.
Hey.
I can't believe the audio. We had a few technical difficulties at the end of the show last week, and they've extended all the way into just now. So we're finally back on the air after a week of technical difficulties.
And we sat here the entire time.
We sat here the entire time. Part of the problem is other shows kept airing while we were trying to get back on the air, and that was a real problem.
Yeah. I didn't even shower.
Well, we can tell. I'm hoping. Be glad at home you're not. We haven't got the smell-o-vision working yet.
But our scientists are working on our top scientists.
Our top scientists, yeah.
Is one of it Wonka?
Gerald and Jamal. Yeah, Wonka.
Can we get Wonka to work on that for you?
So this week on the show, we've got obviously the wonderful Taffeta Darling, the wonderful, well, not so wonderful Jay Skagerberg. Of course, Jedi's behind the board again today.
As always.
And we got John Bragg, who we thought canceled on us.
No.
And then showed up. Because I put a phone number in him wrong in my phone.
And you railed against
him. So now I'm completely confused. He showed up. So I think somebody else is supposed to show up now too. Yeah, I'm thoroughly confused on what's going on.
But they
today.
Were supposed to show up, but they canceled, so they're probably
somebody else who was not supposed to show up canceled, but now says somebody else is coming in to represent them.
So somebody who didn't cancel decided they were going to go ahead and cancel and then show up, but send somebody else in their place.
I have so confusing today.
It is.
But otherwise, the whole show is booked. So if we need to, we'll find a little room to squeeze them in.
Know
about that.
That's an arm.
No, don't hurt your hands on those pipes of steel there.
Oh no, almost a broken nail.
So I guess I should say that last night I finally got to watch Batman: The Dark Knight Rises.
Yay.
And we're not going to talk about it on the show today. But I just wanted everybody to know it's been so long, and I'm horrible about watching movies on time.
America, and, you can stop holding
you
your breath.
You can stop waiting. Because it took me like 4 months to see The Avengers, and I was horrible. And so this is obviously Dark Knight took me even longer.
Oh, you got me beat.
Do you? Really? Good. So I'm horrible about that. Well, it's a show. We're supposed to review comic books, movies on the show, and the biggest one of the year, and I didn't get it, or second biggest one of the year, whatever. I didn't get around to it, but finally watched it last night. We'll talk about that. We're going to do a whole Batman showcase.
I look forward to it.
In a month. Yeah. So we're going to do all three of the Nolan Batmans and review them all together and everything like that.
I think we should watch all of the Batmans.
I think we should just air all the Batmans on the show instead.
And just do commentary.
And that's free content. Yeah, why don't we do that?
We can do a Mystery Science Theater 3000 and just sit here and watch them and just like make up our own verbiage for the people.
Honestly, the Batman and Robin or Batman Forever, all those ones, you don't even need to make commentary for it. It's like, okay, get ready to watch something absolutely ridiculous there.
Well, have y'all ever listened to the commentary on the Joel Schumacher Batman, the one with Batman and Robin and everything like that?
No.
Oh, it's great commentary. It's an hour and a half of, I'm so sorry. I'm really, really sorry. I swear to God, this could have, I'm so sorry.
Did you take that from a Simpsons episode with
Postman.
The Kevin Costner?
Yes,
and the
it
Postman?
Is.
I know these things.
I was wondering if you were going to call me on that.
I must have missed that one.
It's an homage if it's in a different genre than you work, or if it's in black and white. It's an homage. It's not stealing.
It's not ripping it off.
Okay.
It's not a ripoff.
They're like showing off these like really cool televisions. They're shopping for a new one, and like Lisa goes up to this like high definition one, and it's like the postman's going, and then Kevin Costner's doing the auditory, and he's just like, "I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. Yeah. I'm so sorry."
And I don't think it's. I think it's okay to steal from a show that 50% of the shots are stolen from Citizen Kane or you know Godfather or something like that. That
they
seems to make it okay. So, and then we got John Bragg on today from. Starstruck.
Starstruck.
Another show on the station. Tell us a little bit about that real quick.
Well, Starstruck.
Don't give it all away. Don't blow the load. But
yeah, okay. Well, Starstruck is on Thursday. Hello. It's on Thursday evenings at 6:30 to 8:00. The host is CJ Starr. We have Damon Smith, Patrick Puckett, and myself, John Bragg. Normally, you hear me more than you see me because I'm usually in the seat that Jedi's in right now.
Behind the
scenes. I'm probably one-tenth of the producer that he is. So our show has a lot of hilarity on airing.
See, I like that. That's half of the content on this show. I tell people when mistakes happen, they're so worried. I'm like, that's free content on a comedy show.
That's right.
You don't have to worry about it. Just pretend that you meant it to happen and you built it into the show.
Yeah, right? Just roll with it.
I talk about behind the curtain a lot or letting people see, you know, behind the scenes.
Yeah.
Really,
oh, yeah.
I pretend that's built into the show, but that just covers our ass in case anything ever happens.
Oh, we meant to
you
do
mean
that.
When anything happens.
Yeah, when. Yeah, exactly. But so today we're going to talk a little bit about the new reboot of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle comics. They have the new series that's out, but they also have the micro series and Infestation. A little bit of a crossover, and it's the IDW comic books.
Yeah.
So we're going to be talking a little bit about that, and we have special guest Ninja Turtle Taffeta Darling in here talking
about
that.
That's right.
So she actually called me this morning, worried if she couldn't come in because she hadn't read all of them. And I'm like, Taff, we've reviewed films we haven't even watched.
Yeah, I mean, you know, so
I'm only on number five of this and two of this. Am I going to be viable? Is it even point? Is it even worth it? Should I come? I don't want people to just sit there and be like, what is she doing there? What's the point?
To be honest, I'd never heard of Ninja Turtles until yesterday. So
I know, you didn't even know what that shirt was. I had to point it out to you and be like, this is actually a Ninja Turtle shirt. It's not a science shirt.
It just happened to work out
there. No, it's a Daredevil shirt.
Yeah, that's what it is. As we talked about last week.
You should get a marker and just draw just like a little red spot
right there.
I'm not going
to disgrace the Ninja Turtles by drawing on this shirt. Silly. So we're also going to talk a little bit about the franchise and how big it's come and where it came from and how it's changed. And so in addition to talking about the reboot itself, how Ninja Turtles has changed over the course of, you know, what, 20 years now,
Yep.
Yes.
So, and then the Michael Bay film that was going to come out that got scrapped because there was so much negative press. Because last night I set up, while watching The Dark Knight Rises, legally, I'm sure, on my computer, I was able to read the Ninja Turtle script from the Michael Bay movie.
Wow.
So we'll talk a little bit about that. And I'll tell you this, just to get some people going, it was the best thing I've ever read in my life.
Really?
That should piss off a lot of the fanboys.
Yeah, right, you're definitely going to get a lot of hate mail.
So we'll talk about that, too. Well, now that we know what's going on, we know who's going to be on the show and what we're doing, does anybody have anything? What's new? This is the news and update segment. So, Jedi, you were telling us there's a new show going to be on the station. What's that about?
Yeah, man. Reggae Roots. It's starting this next Tuesday. It's a reggae show. You know, I'm a big fan of reggae music, so we're going to have...
I love Reaganomics, so I can't wait to tune in.
I think that's a big part of
it. Yeah, is it going to be a big economic show?
Hell no.
Reaganomics!
You know, actually, Dallas has a lot of really good reggae bands.
Yeah,
so we're going to give a spotlight to that. And, you know, we just completed one of the segments today called Let's Call Jamaica. And we just randomly called a few businesses in Jamaica. So
I want to hear that.
It was actually really fun. In fact, we got one of the guys to start singing to us.
Really?
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. Randomly.
I'm gonna have
cool.
to steal that segment too. Cool. Not Jamaica. We'll just call and promote our show to random people at
comic
home.
Comic book shops.
You know, yeah, there we go.
Can we just start calling comic book shops? We're coming for you, Keith.
Yeah, Keith's gonna get it first, the hardest. Any other news? So we got reggae show now on the station, which is really exciting. Of course, we have the beer show coming up on the 7th of September, which has just been taking off like crazy. So we're gonna have a lot of people down there for that.
I'll make it eventually.
You should. It's a lot of fun.
Make sure you have a place to stay, like in the area.
See,
though,
that's the thing.
Yeah, you tend not to be sober by the end of the
night. It's ridiculous. Everybody starts the show sober at about 10 o'clock, but we give out so many free samples of beer and. During the reviews and stuff like that, by midnight, gone. Of course, usually there's an after party over at my house, and last time there was a hippie.
My house too, ass.
Well, sorry about that. It's my home.
Odd couple over here and shit.
But I'm sorry, our place, yes. The sexual dungeon that is Jay and Dell's place.
I don't think anyone calls it that.
What else happens at the beer show besides beer drinking?
Well, we do, let's go through the segments. There's 15 minutes of, like, bullshitting at the beginning of the show to fill 15 minutes.
Okay.
Right? And that's pretty much what this 15 minutes here. Right.
Right. Yeah.
So, we have drinking games. We have beer trivia.
Yep.
At the beginning of the show, one of the things we do is, there we go. What we do is I read off beer trivia facts, 10 to 15 beer trivia facts, at the beginning of the show, just give them to the host.
Right.
Then at the end, after 2 hours of drinking, everybody has to take a quiz.
And then we grade the quiz.
And then we grade the quiz, and the hosts get awards
the
depending
quiz
on how
is very
well they
difficult.
Do.
Especially after 2 hours of drinking.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there's somebody gave up last time and just threw their paper in the air because they knew they weren't going to win.
I think that was multiple choice? She was just like, screw it.
Yeah.
No, you have to write out the answer.
Yeah, yeah.
Those are the worst.
But it's pretty good. Some of them I can still remember. But what's great is we have one of the hosts in the show is a local nano brewer who's certified in doing beer reviews. So he actually like took all the classes and he has certifications so he can actually rank beers and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And last time he called me out on like two of the facts that we pulled offline. He's like, well, that's Bolivia, whatever. Yeah. That's fine. So we had to change it on the fly because he knows way more about it than even the internet does. And the internet knows a lot of things.
Yeah.
But so we do. And then there's beer reviews. We hand out samples. They break open a keg on Friday nights. Of some new beer that's usually never been seen before.
It's the cask ready beer.
The fecking.
Yeah.
Where is it?
The fecking.
The fecking. Excuse me? Okay, yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. What?
It's a public fecking.
Excuse me?
So
yeah, you go there and you just watch them feck right there.
Yeah, so
right
there's a
right
segment
the
where they break
fecking.
Open a new beer, and I believe this month fecking. We're doing, and then what we do is we pick one type of beer, And then we, for one segment, they talk about the history of that type of beer. So like last month was Pilsners. So they talk about what makes Pilsners different. And then they talk about, and then they pick like six beers and they review those six. But what's cool is those beers are also available in the store. So if you want to stop by earlier and pick them up and take them home, you can either watch the show with it and go along with the review. And then one of then the next segment is they actually review the six beers, talk about how they're different, what makes them Pilsners. And I think this month is stouts. And if you go online to Bottoms Up Dallas,
filling segment.
Yeah, bottomsupdallas.com, on the front page they list the six stouts. Mm-hmm. So you can actually pick them up beforehand and watch or be there live and do it.
Yeah.
But St. Arnold's is going to be giving us five beers for October.
And I host that one too.
You host
that? That's gonna be, oh yeah, he's on the show. I don't host it, luckily. That's just a freebie for me.
You just drink.
I do all the damn work beforehand and then everybody else gets to have their pretty faces on camera and I'm ducking out. So
this is the money maker for it right here.
It is.
Brings
it screams
in.
Beer.
You got a good beer drinking face. look good even drunk.
That's right. I actually look, the more you drink, the better I look.
Yeah, he brings in the pesos, that's for sure. But well, I'll tell you what, we're going to take a quick break so we can knock back a few beers, and we're going to come back and review the IDW's new Ninja Turtle reboot.
Yep.
See you guys in a bit.
Was never big enough for the both of us. Cause we know that we could never agree. And now I've really gotta get this off my chest. And you gotta hear me, I'm not the one to ever take things serious. But this is your last goodbye. Make way for the king as you fall to your knees. But I'll die before I stand for this. Oh, I hate to be the one who's always breaking the ice. But I've got
ha 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 ha.
Oh, well, it looks like we're back on the air. A little too soon for my taste.
Yeah, I'm a little gassy. Sorry.
It's great to have the cute girl say that on the show.
Well, like right when you came back, I was about to burp, and I was like, God dang it.
Yeah, the worst part is right now at home, I know you can't see this, but we're stifling, holding it in right now, because having to let one rip right before
we came
back.
It's a mixture of garlic and ruby red bird. So
this
sounds
good, though.
That's a good aroma.
Can we get these guys to sponsor this show?
I'm sure the next person who uses that mic is really going to appreciate you.
I can rub some toothpaste on it.
Yeah. So I guess we should start talking about the Ninja Turtles. Now, for those of you that don't know, because you're fucking retarded.
Yeah, what's wrong with you?
The Ninja Turtles were created back by Eastman and Laird back in the 80s, right? I'm just double checking that it wasn't even further back than I thought.
It was early to mid-80s.
Yeah, because the television show, the cartoon that we all know and love, right? We all know and love.
Yes.
Okay.
Love it.
And it's actually closer to 30 years.
Yeah. Oh, God. Man, this still throws me off. People say 20 years ago now. They don't mean...
They mean the 90s.
They mean the 90s. Yeah. God. Yeah. Oh, my. All right. So, but still handsome as fuck. So that's...
I am quite handsome.
You are. You are.
I don't like... this?
Huh?
Is this working?
Yeah, this is working really well. So, Eastman and Laird... They did some... something they were drawing for fun. They borrowed some money from a relative and printed the first issue of the Ninja Turtles, which was black and white, and they had red bandanas.
Yeah. It makes it difficult to keep up sometimes unless you actually like read it and you know whose personality is coming
through. Right, and it was the personalities that came through because they didn't have the belt buckles with the letters on it. They didn't have the colored bandana and stuff like that.
They did that because children are stupid.
Yeah, they are. For instance, I locked my son in the little dog cage the other day because he was acting up. And it took him, he didn't figure out how to get out.
His hands are small enough to get through the cage. Yeah. So, like, he could have unlocked
it. Really stupid. So
I'm guessing this is the parenting section of the show.
Right, yeah. Man, I make deals with him all the time. Like, like my wife will cook him dinner. And where? Do you like our girl? So, my wife will cook him dinner. And I'm, for the people at home, I have no wife and no kids. No one's going to take me home. But,
that's the truth.
People don't even know, to be honest, if I really have a dog or a cat at home when I talk about those, too.
No, but, I'll vouch for those, too.
Oh, really?
I really like one of them, and I hate the other
one. The idea of me going home every day after the show after being so zany and ridiculous, and it's just me and my cat having dinner across a candle from each other. That's my lonely, lonely life. Yeah. Zelda's cooked us a nice tuna fish dinner, and I'm eating it. It's so sad.
Out of the can.
Right? That's classy. So the turtles.
Turtles,
so anyway, Eastman and Laird created this thing, and it kind of took off as a phenomenon pretty quick. And it's basically about turtles that were mutated into half humanoid turtles, and they know ninjutsu, and they're trained by a large rat. So most people have
a large rat who is the reincarnation of a ninja from
only Beautiful in the
Japan.
New one.
Yeah,
yeah. And so that's what I guess we should start about is some of the bigger differences. Most people I think are familiar with the television show from the 80s, and I don't think so many people are familiar with the black and white comic books. Which you should check out because in the very first issue, they kill the Shredder. So it was a lot more violent originally. There was a lot more blood.
They don't just kill him. They brutally
Well, they cut off his
him.
Arms and legs, execute him, and then throw him in a dumpster. So
it's a little like Star Wars.
Yeah.
Yeah, kind of.
So
Except dark better in no way connected
no way
to
related
George
at
Lucas.
All.
Yeah. Well, they're going to do prequels. Well, they'll ruin everything.
Oh, yeah. There you go.
So... But the new ones, what they did was Eastman is in on this, who was one of the writers and one of the co-creators of the show, and so IDW has picked up a new run of the Ninja Turtle series. Now to do it, they've rebooted a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the Turtles' personalities kept the same. Leonardo's still the leader. Michelangelo's the party dude. Donatello's
still the best.
The science guy that's debatable.
Best.
And
Raphael's still a badass.
Right, and if you don't know, Leonardo's the one with the blue. Donatello's the one with the bow staff and purple. Mikey's the orange and the nunchucks. Oh. And Raphael's the best one, objectively, with the size. So there we go. There's another picture.
I love that. Look how happy they look.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, and that's the thing is in the
especially rose. Since he's been cut in half.
Yeah.
Donatello.
Well, he's coming out of the sewer.
No, but the best part is to not look at it like that. Look at it like he got cut in half and he's sitting on the ground.
He's still going.
So right.
It's fine, guys. Still going.
Now they did do a reboot of the cartoon back in the 90s. I think it was
they've done multiple reboots of that.
Well, yeah, but I think the other more popular one that some kids would be more familiar with is the Back from the Sewers one they did back in 1997, which was okay. They didn't hate it, but they definitely made them more modern. They took all their logos off. They, you know, they had the bandanas, but everything looked more hip. And the only great thing about, not the only great thing, but one of the nice things about that is the series finale of that one was a crossover between the 80s Turtles, and they get the they time jump, and they meet the Turtles from the 80s.
Yeah.
Did you ever see that episode?
I didn't. I'm in
Oh, man, it's called Turtles Forever, and it's the single greatest thing. They
Because it's not them. It's like an alternate timeline.
Yeah, it's an alternate timeline, so. And actually all the new Turtles are jealous that everybody has the belt buckles with their initials. They're like, well, how come those guys have their letters on their belt buckles? We don't have that.
That's pretty cool.
And it's great because they got the old voice actors from the original Ninja Turtles, and they got the new voice actors in the studio, and so it's actually the guys doing the original. And the guy who did Raphael does Donatello now, and they even make a couple of jokes about how Raphael and Donatello sound alike.
Oh, cool.
Is the two. So, and of course, April O'Neil, my first crush on a cartoon character. But
that's cute.
So let's talk about.
Have you ever cosplayed as April O'Neil?
No, with the red hair, about it I think that numerous you could, times.
I think that you could pull it off pretty easily.
Because it's just a simple jumpsuit. I've got the boots already and the belt.
There you go.
So maybe.
So nice. You know, get on that, please, for the good of mankind.
Yeah, please. And okay, so the original one, the original cartoon, especially the original comic books, were very graphic. The original cartoon was very playful. It was definitely aimed at kids. So you know, the foot was changed from actual human being ninja soldiers
into
robots, which is, you know, as everybody knows, if you switch on robots, you can kill all of them you want. Nobody feels guilty, right? So it
basically
was,
they wanted Leonardo to be able to cut things in half.
Yeah, and that was and that's real important.
For Raphael to be able to stab
and
things.
I appreciate that.
Yeah, I'm totally fine with that.
So, but they also had like the turtle blimp, and they Schumachered it up a little bit. It went, I mean, for the cartoon, it went from, you know, a serious take on like the Ronin samurai warrior type, which originally that's what it was. It was like a very Kurosawa type thing. The cartoon tried to make it more marketable and to people.
Look
now,
at that,
of
look
course,
at that
then you had the movies. They were done by Jim Henson, and those were just amazingly dark. The first one, especially.
One of the few times I will say that a sequel was better than the original.
Really?
I like the sequel.
See, I still like the original better, but yeah, I enjoy the sequel.
Yeah, I mean, they're both great in my
opinion. Well, and Vanilla Ice is in the second one singing Go Ninja, Go Ninja, Go.
I just like Super Shredder, played by the wrestler Kevin Nash.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about that. But as you can see on the screen right now, the Jim Henson Company did the turtle suits. And at the time, those were just, they really still are amazing works. Yeah. So the Turtles have really gone through different, you know, different iterations. And, you know, they've gone from being a serious take on Japanese samurai life to a whimsical play on cartoons, you know, to a real life drama. Because let's face it, the Ninja Turtle movie was a drama.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a great ass kicking film, but it was dark.
What did you think about the rebooted one that came out a couple years
ago? I didn't see that one. The animated 3D one. That's the only Ninja Turtle thing I haven't seen.
Oh, you should definitely check it out. It's worth a look.
By the way, I want one of these.
Why don't we have those?
I don't know.
I mean, for this show especially, we should all be wearing one.
But I mean, you can see they've spawned, you know, over the last 30 years, they've spawned, you know, hats, t-shirts. I mean, they're, well, look at this, a guitar.
All right, that's a sweet-ass guitar right there.
So very popular, obviously very marketable. They make great action figures. And, you know, Eastman and Laird have been doing just fine. So I was really interested because after the original comics, and Eastman helped out a little bit on the original cartoon in the 80s, there hasn't really been, you know, the creators have pretty much stayed away from it for a while. Well, this reboot by IDW has Eastman coming back on writing a lot of the stories. But there's some noticeable changes that, I'll be honest, I think work for the better. They're trying to get back a little bit to the grittier. Mm-hmm. They're trying to get back to more of the drama stories, whereas one thing I liked about the cartoons in the 70s was that they did have a story arc. I'm sorry, in the 80s. Then the 20s. Was when they all wore top hats and they were all dapper. And
that would be, yeah.
But,
do a noir episode.
Do a noir episode. But they actually did that with Donatello one time when he was a detective in the early 90s. But They're trying to get back to kind of find a balance between playful and gritty. And I think the new series does it really well. The art is fantastic in it.
It's very dark and moody, considering most of the Turtle World takes place at night.
You know,
they still,
and in sewers.
It still has a playfulness to it, but it is really dark and moody. And I think the lady who's doing it, she's pretty good so far. I've enjoyed her art.
Because the comics, even done after the cartoon got popular in the 80s, they had Ninja Turtle Adventures, and they were the same type of playful, witty, wisecracking, you know, party guys. And essentially, that's kind of what they were. They were whimsical. And I really enjoyed the take back to the harsher tones. For instance, let's start actually discussing the differences now between most of the, you know, the canon of Ninja Turtles and what the new one is doing. And for the most part, we'll leave out the original black and white stories because most people still haven't read those. Most people don't know them. And that actually disappeared so quick once the whimsical form came on.
Right.
But the new versions, first of all, start out with a couple hundred years ago that there was a family, and it was Hamato Yoshi, and he has four sons. And they're executed by Rokusaki.
Yes.
So the new turtles are somehow supernatural reincarnations of a family that was executed in feudal Japan. And in this one, they play a lot on the feudal Japan mythology. And there's lots of flashbacks. So instead of just being, oh, these are the turtles in present day time, there's lots of flashbacks to their lives as actual human beings hundreds of years ago.
Yeah.
And the morals and the lessons are very much more Eastern than the, you know, the westernized American playfulness. And, well, Jay, what are some of your favorite differences? Like, for instance, it starts now with when the turtles are created by the ooze, Raphael is separated from them.
Yep, that was, well, all right, some of my favorite parts about this are the fact that they tie the turtles more closely with Dimension X and Baxter Stockman, because the turtles and Splinter, they were originally being experimented on by April O'Neil, who is no longer a reporter. She's a intern working for Baxter Stockman.
Right. The original origin story was she's a newspaper reporter. They're just turtles, and Hamato Yoshi fled Japan. Yeah. They got ooze on them in the sewer.
And then things happen. But in this one, Splinter is, you know, he's been experimented on.
He's
a smart lab rat already. And then they get transformed even further by a mutagen. And
an intentional mutagen, as opposed to one that just was having to be created and got dropped. They're actively, in Baxter Stockman's lab, they're actively working on creating these.
Oh, and for those of you out there who don't know, Baxter Stockman is a reoccurring villain and sort of a nemesis who blames a lot of the troubles in his life on the turtles and his failure to capture them, experiment on them, and complete his scientific work.
Right, and in the original work, he was just some guy that the Shredder found.
He made ray guns, basically.
Yeah, and in this one, he's an active creator of the Ninja Turtles. They made him black in this one, because that's really popular nowadays. And they made a...
Well, after the whole black as a person or black?
Well, I figured after the whole Donald Glover Spider-Man thing, they were probably like, we just better appease
Donald Glover would have been a badass Spider-Man.
We don't want him rising up, so let's appease the blacks by changing one character over to a black guy.
Way to go, comic book universe. Very progressive of you.
Well, there's the new... we'll talk about this later, but the new Green Lantern is...
Yeah, we'll get to that another time. This is Ninja Turtle time.
That's a whole hour on its own.
Well, it's green, so it kind of ties in. Yeah. But anyway, so Baxter Stockman, but what's great is they took all these characters that have been canonized over the years by happenstance, and they're tying them in together into a solid origin
story.
Yeah,
they've created a much more cohesive story and more of a reason for them to keep running into each other and interacting with each other.
Right.
And one of my favorite issues, actually, is when Donatello goes to a science convention and he meets this guy who, it turns out, they would troll each other on the internet.
Yes, that was that was the Donatello micro series.
Yeah, and Donatello winds up having to save his life from Baxter Stockman, and Stockman is just, like, stark raving mad. He's like, oh, shit, it's one of the turtles. Drop everything else, get this turtle, and, like, it shows just his psychosis over these walking, talking turtles, and he can't explain it to most people because, you know, if you try to tell the authorities there's human-sized talking turtles in the sewers, your ass is going to a mental ward.
Well,
so,
what's great is one of the things I really liked is that always Raphael has been represented as the outsider of the group. In the movie,
more complex.
In the movie, he's the one that's beaten unconscious and the other turtles have to take care of him, and he's like unconscious throughout the movie. But he's always the one with the angst, the anger, the one that doesn't fit in. And they finally gave him a reason for that in this series.
I do like that.
When the mutagen finally got on the turtles, he was separated from the rest of them by a new villain.
Mr. Hob.
Old Hob,
yeah.
Yeah, Old Hob. Pulls
him
away.
Which is another old name for the devil.
Right, so. And I did like that reference. But Raphael's pulled away, and so the turtles, until they become teenagers, are essentially without Raphael.
But they know that he's supposed to be there.
Right, exactly.
Their big quest in the beginning is find Raphael.
And I like that in the originals, you know, all of them, like we talked about, wore red bandanas. But, of course, in the newer ones, they wear color. And they had this great idea. Yeah, pizza, there you go.
Turtles, look out.
But I love the idea that they pay an homage to that by when it first starts off in the new series, all the turtles wear red. And that's in honor of their lost brother. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So all the Ninja Turtles are wearing red. Raphael, who grows up on the street alone, meets Casey Jones, which always shows why Casey Jones and he always got along better as the disgruntled people. There was never really a reason for that. Well, now they bonded for a while the other turtles, and it's a great dynamic about showing how Raphael and Casey are the outsiders of the group. Yeah. But Raphael has no bandana, and the other three wear red. So I like it. That's back to the origin story of they all look alike.
And that's why Raphael adopts red, because once he finds them and they can no longer pay tribute, it's like, well, I guess red's my color.
Yeah. Right. And he takes it. Now, and that was my favorite. I actually teared up when I read the Christmas issue of this, where Splinter gives them all of their gifts. And it's the same time that they pull in Raphael. They find him on the streets. And as a gift for Christmas, now that their brother has been returned, Raphael gets a red bandana.
Oh, so he hasn't gotten there yet.
Oh, it's so nice. Great. Yeah. Okay, he gets. They give him a red bandana so that now he's part of the family, and then Splinter gives the other turtles their present, and it's the other color bandanas. Nice. So it was nice for just like two pages. Raphael gets brought up. They're all four wearing red bandanas, and then they roll over into the new generation of turtles of all of them, and it was just so wonderfully, honestly touching that they cared enough about the story to pay a tribute to the original, pay tribute to where they're going. And to bring Raphael into the group, mm-hmm. and then move on from there.
Oh, and just to further tie everything together, April O'Neil is Casey Jones's tutor. They go to the same college.
Yeah. Okay, I haven't gotten there yet either. I am liking what they're doing with Casey Jones about how Raphael like runs into him and the whole story with his dad and all that stuff.
Yeah. But they give Casey Jones a reason to be angry as well as
and the reason he's so tough is because he was abused constantly.
Exactly. Right. He was able to do it, and then a little bit of his backstory. Well, if you're so tough to do all this, I like that conversation. Well, then why can't you step up to your dad? Pretty much kick his ass for always kicking yours.
And what's great is if you ever read this, especially the comics from the 90s, the actual comics is they're whimsical. Playful, they're silly, and they're about having fun and selling merchandise first and foremost.
Yes.
Not merchandising.
Merchandising.
So and then so when they did the reboot, I was like, well, are they going to try to make it super realistic? And they do, but they also keep a lot of the playfulness in the sense that Mikey's a little wisecracking, but even the villains like Hob and stuff like that, and not alopecia, which is
skin disorder.
Not Apocalypse. What is the other cat? The female cat that's the new character.
Oh,
she has a weird name. I can't possibly think of it.
I haven't gotten.
But
that yet.
I like that they don't even reveal the Shredder in the first one. They actually let it build up to it. But so overall, it's a great redo. It's like somebody finally took the time to take all of these different versions and say, okay, let's make a cohesive universe that these characters live in.
Which
that
you can only really do with one of the original creators.
Yeah, I guess they moved to try to reboot something that's been such institutionalized.
Yeah, so but it's also been so all over the place. I mean, from two and you could argue three or four movies, but really been the first two gritty, serious, dark dramas. A whimsical cartoon show, whimsical comedies, a black and white, homage to Kurosawa and Japanese culture. That's a lot to work together. And this one really puts it all together. It ties up loose characters. And when you talk about a reboot, this is the type of reboot I like to see, mm-hmm. where it's everything that you liked about all the different versions of the Turtles finally cohesively put together where fans can enjoy. So real fast, though, I do want to talk about this infestation one real fast. IDW does, like every other comic book in the world, they have to have a reason for it to tie into other titles occasionally. Yeah. So they can do crossovers. And theirs is the infestation where the universes occasionally mesh. And I haven't had a chance to read these.
I haven't either.
And so, but Tavita has. So tell us a little bit about the infestation.
I did. I read the first two issues so far. I think that's all that's in there. And pretty much it starts off with Donatello, which of course is my favorite. Him and his sciencey ways. All these different, storms are coming. People are disappearing, and there's starting to be more appearances of, humanoids that are getting reported. And so they're starting to freak out and think maybe more people are starting to realize that, they're down in the sewer. Pretty much where the storyline's going is there's these different monsters, and Donatello's looking at these 1920s, stories and charts towards something that was happening back in 1920s is starting to, reemerge and resurface nowadays. And so they think they're safe in this tunnel, and all of a sudden, you know, the power goes out, and they're trying to figure out what's going on. And so they actually go into this part of the sewers where they've never been before, where they had no idea it was there. And so there's all these different, like, you know, rats that are being mutated, as well as, like, you know, other parts of, I think, like, some squids and something else. You don't really know exactly what's going on yet because it's still new, but there's something else that's in the sewer with them that's getting mutated. And so
And this is only 2 issues in.
Yeah,
right?
It's okay. Already 2 issues in, and it's having to do a lot with something that happened in the 1920s. Like, some sort of cult, even. Okay. So we don't really know exactly what's going on yet. But the last issue I read, it showed Donatello getting separated from the bunch and getting pulled underwater into, like, a whole nother part of the sewer that they didn't even know existed.
Hmm.
And so, you know, it seems pretty cool. I can see where the infestation part is, because there's apparently supposed to be all these other humanoids that are going to be coming out of the sewer,
right,
that they didn't know exist. So it seems like it could be something cool for them because, you know, here they are thinking they're sheltered and completely blocked off.
I'm watching Jedi pull up Ninja Turtle dubstep.
Yeah. Sorry, I got distracted.
So, no. We might be... That needs to play during the next break if we can possibly do that.
Nice. But I think, you know, I think it's going to be pretty interesting to see, because I think where they're going with this is to say, hey, there's not just, like, you know, Ninja Turtles that are in this sewer. There's actually a whole bunch more to this particular sewer that was used in, like, you know, occult sacrifices, maybe, and some sort of, like, you know, previous practices of this particular ooze / humanoid / section of the series.
Well, that's fine. Now I'm going to go read that. Okay, so let's get a rating on this real fast. Jay, you've read... No, I guess I should say they're 13 issues in, mm-hmm. So it's been going for a full year now. It came out September of last year, and from the first issue, I was pretty happy with it. But now a year later, Jay, what's your opinion?
I think it's gold. I think that if you like comic books, I mean, you know, people around our age, of course we know Ninja Turtles, but even, you know, kids these days, they're serious enough that it's good, but it's not, like, overly dark.
Yeah, as a 30-year-old adult, I'm enjoying the story. Like, I'm not just enjoying the turtles.
A child could read this. I'm not saying read it to your 5-year-olds. It could really, you know, confuse the hell out of them. But I really think this is a great book for everybody. I think they're doing a great job with the story. It is more story and character driven than a lot of comics that are out there now, where it's just like, all right, now we have to gear up for a big fight and punch something. Instead of just having everything be about a fight, it's about the characters and what's going on with them. And so I highly recommend it. I think it's excellent.
Taff?
You know, I haven't gotten nearly as far as you guys
have.
As
a female, what do you think about this?
As a female, I think it's actually, you know, really, it's actually, I'm really enjoying it. I like the different take on April O'Neil from her not being, you know, with the film. She's more of kind of a sciencey, you know, techie person. Again, I haven't gotten nearly as far as you guys have, but so far I'm enjoying it. I'm liking the little chains that have been done. At first I was, you know, kind of like on the fence about, well, I don't want to see another reboot-ish type, you know, comic, but with Eastman being on this particular
thing, that's the thing that got me willing to try it.
He's got a lot of input that he's, you know, putting out there. So I'm enjoying it. I would probably give it like an, you know, an 8 out of 10.
Oh, very nice.
You know, 4 out of 5.
John, as somebody who hasn't read the new comics, what do you think about them?
I have not read them, but I do remember the movies from the 80s. And Spice Baby Guy.
Vanilla Ice.
Vanilla Ice.
Doing the ninja rap.
Spice Baby. Now, see, that's a crossover. Spice Girls and Vanilla Ice, I want to see now. You just came up with gold right there, buddy.
That I do remember that movie from back then in the 80s, and I enjoyed it. And I do remember the Ninja Turtles when they first came out. I'm a lot older than you. Well, not that much older, but I'm older than you guys. And I remember when it first started. You said you're almost a 30-year-old adult.
Yeah.
31. You were probably just born when they came out.
Yeah, I remember when the cartoon series aired. I was about 6 or 7 already.
Yep.
But I read the comics.
I thought it was
later.
Good. I remember some of the characters you guys were talking about. Casey Jones. Always liked his character.
Mm-hmm.
If I was gonna pick an actor to play him, it would be the guy from Boston, the one who just did the Ted movie.
Oh,
that
Mark
would
Wahlberg?
Actually be pretty good. He does have an explosive, violent personality,
yeah.
And I actually like him in a lot of stuff.
I really
that's
like
actually
him
a good
in,
idea.
Yeah. If I was going to pick somebody to do that character, it would be him.
That would be a good
idea. I think
idea,
he'd pull
really.
It off really well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I could see that actually.
Yeah.
So
I would go with George Takei as Donatello.
That's oh my!
Yeah.
So, well, I gotta say, as the host whose opinion means more than anybody else in the show, that yeah, I give it either a 9 out of 10 or 10 out of 10, as in. When I walked into something that I wholeheartedly love, I mean, I have been a Ninja Turtles fan. I had all the action figures when I was a kid. I had the little bus or the turtle van. I even had the blimp. I had Ninja Turtle sheets. I have, you know, the Ninja Turtles shirt now at 31 years old.
So merchandising.
I own every video game they had. Oh, I was a sucker. My dad actually made me Ninja Turtle weapons when we were a kid. We have a, you know, manufacturing shop when we were kids. He made me a bow staff, a katana sword, scythe, and nunchucks.
That's cool.
And I had them hanging on my walls, and I even bought all the little patches and made my own. And I even made myself a robe, a Ninja Turtle robe, when I was like 8. I sewed it together when I was 8. With the shell pattern on back and the Ninja Turtle logo right here.
I wish you still had that.
I do. Actually, yeah. It's packed away. And if I can find that, it only comes down to like half down my crotch now because I was a little kid. But I'll wear that on the show.
You should definitely wear that.
He saves it for sexy times.
Yeah. So Carol gets a treat.
Poor
of that. yeah. So I've been a fan from the beginning. It's one of my absolute favorite franchises ever. It's like up there with Legend of Zelda with me. And I have thoroughly enjoyed what they're doing with this. And I've seen some bad takes on it before. I used to be subscribed to the Ninja Turtle magazine in the early 90s.
Oh my.
Had 14 episodes issues before they canceled it. But
love it.
So, yeah, I give this a 10 out of 10, especially for, wow, this beer is really good. This is pretty good. But especially as a reboot, well, to celebrate, we had beer and pizza today for the Ninja Turtles.
That's
but
true.
I would definitely say that this is, especially if you're a Ninja Turtle fan like me, this is something you need to pick up and you need to add to your collection and you need to read. They're going to start wrapping one of the major story arcs in the next two issues, so you can wait till the hardbound edition comes out. But it'll be worth it. I mean, definitely grab it.
I like to grab the hardbound ones myself.
I like to grab anything hard.
I like to grab the hardbound ones too.
Hey, so Dale, I gotta ask, man. So what's the deal with these pictures?
Those are just I grabbed those because we saw some of the other costumes come up. But this is about 2 or 3 years ago. These came out. Here, John, you might want
to. That's ridiculous.
Now, people may also know I like Ninja Turtles a lot, but I love me some boobies as well. And I hate to say this, but there's a good chance that at some point in the past, I touched myself to that picture. But Ninja Turtles and females in sexy, shiny clothes.
I wish they would have painted themselves green.
Just go
there. Oh, there was another one that I didn't put on here where these girls did paint themselves green and dress like, and it was not sexy at all. It was really creepy looking.
I've seen some cosplay April O'Neils that are just.
Oh, yeah. Well, first cartoon
you wear
crush.
Costumes, right?
Yeah, I do.
Would you wear one of those?
No. I would make my own.
Well, Oh, yeah, that's the other thing. She makes her own. So I also give those girls a 10 out of 10.
Yes.
So.
I give them a 10 out of 10 for pretending to know what they're
for
doing.
For pretending to know what they're doing. Yeah, I doubt any one of those bitches that read a comic. Exactly. Read
what are we dressed as? Lizards?
Yeah. Oh, I like
the
lizards.
The new thing from Spice Girls.
I like the voice. So
that's my most effeminate
I'm assuming voice. That's the Michelangelo version of the girls. So, and okay, so yeah, I'm 10 out of 10. You need to go and check these out. We're gonna take a break, and when we come back, we're gonna be talking with John Bragg of Starstruck, another show on the station here, and we're gonna be talking about stand-up comedy. So right. We'll see you in just a few minutes. Enjoy the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle dubstep that we found.
Oh, that's great.
About how four ordinary household pets became wisecracking amphibians. Eat the loving amphibians. 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 We'll be right back.
court case.
You'd be surprised how often I burp in the microphone from when I'm eating off the air.
That's what happened to my
You'd
family.
Be surprised how often I burp in the microphone from when I'm eating. Whoa, why am I hearing that? That was weird. I got the feedback of that. Yeah. So, all night. So, we got Taffy to stick around. She was going to have to head out because she normally has a fear of, you said Negroes, right? And so she was wanting to get out of here. And I said, no. John's a great guy. You should definitely.
She said
people of color.
It's honestly just like the
and
worst.
And then she does this. She goes, you know, those types. And I was like, oh, come on.
No.
Really?
So, I really have to go now.
So, but we convinced her to stick around and talk to John here. And we said, what? Well, no.
It's just wiggle it a little.
No, it's.
That's what she said.
Oh, now it's. Going out for real. There we go. Okay.
All right.
Sorry don't touch it.
Just don't touch it.
So, right, we got her to stick around. But don't worry, there's no Chinaman here. So you're at least good on that today. So, John.
Yeah. But see, I've been accused of being half a person of color.
Oh, how does that work?
It doesn't. I'm not. I am full color.
Nice. So, of course, John, yeah. he's not Chinese flavored color. So, but John, so you like to laugh, I've heard. And you like to,
I like to
right?
make fun. I like to
make
fun.
Oh, good, fun. Good. I like fun things sometimes.
Yep, yep.
I like to insult, make fun of people, get made fun of.
See, I like that.
See, on our show on Starstruck, I'm usually the butt of most of the jokes.
Hey, me too.
Yeah, yeah. It's like I'm the oldest guy there. And they define me as their big brother that lets them pick on them.
They're a good big brother.
So tell us about Starstruck.
Starstruck is four comedians. The host is CJ Starr. And then there's
I see what you did there with the title.
That's
I get it.
Oh,
did you not get that?
Oh, I get it now.
I'll explain it to you later, little girl.
I'm still figuring out what Starstruck means.
Clever.
I'm still learning what voting means.
It's what you got when you saw me walk in. You were starstruck.
I was dreamy. I had big Bugs Bunny dreamy eyes.
You're like, oh, I'm gonna wear my Chun-Li outfit for him.
Whatever the female equivalent of the wolf in Warner Brothers cartoons. So Starstruck, CJ Starr.
CJ Starr, he's the host. And it's Damon Smith. And Patrick Puckett. And Patrick.
That's a superhero name.
Patrick Puckett is hilarious. Him and CJ have probably, all three of them have been doing comedy about the same amount of time, between 5 and 7 years. Mm-hmm. I'm the rookie in the group. I'm the youngest as far as comedy, and they're my mentors.
Wow.
And they've taken me under their wing, and they listen to my stupid little jokes. And
we've been doing the show for a year, and we still don't do comedy.
And they tell me, you're not funny. Work on it. No, but seriously, we do shows all around the Metroplex.
But seriously, I like that coming in from the joke. All right.
We do shows all around the Metroplex, Hyenas Comedy Club, lots of local bars and clubs will put shows together, and there's at least 300 comedians in the Metroplex.
Yeah, it's a surprising thing, a lot.
It's about 300 comedians in the Metroplex, and we do open mics on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday nights. Do shows Friday and Saturday, Sundays, sometimes.
You said Hyenas. Where else do you normally?
Hyenas in Fort Worth and Dallas. And then you got the Addison Improv.
Right.
But the Addison Improv doesn't do open mics. It brings in headliners, and it has like, they will pull from the pool of local comics to host and open. They usually have like people like one of the Murphy brothers, specifically not Eddie. He doesn't do it anymore.
Yeah. I haven't seen funny Eddie Murphy in years.
Yeah, man, right, I'm waiting for that guy to make a comeback so bad.
I watched Coming to America last night, and then a couple days ago, Beverly Hills Cop, and I was like,
can he just do a Bill Murray and just be like, fuck it, I'm going drama, and I'd watch that.
But that's the thing with comics. People get into comedy for many different reasons. A lot of people who have success in comedy see success as a movie.
Yeah.
And they don't want to particularly write and tour forever. They do it with ends to the mean of getting a movie
or a television show
or being on TV.
Yeah.
Like there's one local comic named Tone Bell. He was on a show last Tuesday, which I thought was a really big deal. He won the best comic of Texas a few years back, and he's really good. And he was on there as a character, and he did stand up. And it was pretty clever the way they did it. Because he's a great comedian. Great writer, great comedian.
What's his name again?
Tone Bell.
Tone Bell, okay.
T-O-N-E-B-E-L-L.
Nice name.
His name is Tony. Tone Bell. But it had him bombing in the beginning. He was doing some stuff that wasn't true to him. And that's what comedians have to do. It has to come from a true place.
Yeah.
Or it doesn't just seem real. You have to talk about what's real to you. And they had him saying some stuff that wasn't really true to him. And he said, you know what? Forget this. And the funny part was, he's a black guy. Good looking black man. And I found out he was going to be on the show. And this is a black show. I'm like, oh, this is great for Tone. He's going to get the canoodle with all these sexy black women on TV. They made his character gay.
Oh, yeah. That's a shame.
I have nothing wrong. No problem with gay people. Yeah. It's no problem. Nothing wrong. And he's not gay. But they made his character right. gay. He didn't get to canoodle. Fondle some of these beautiful women. Because you know that's what
that's
he was thinking.
That's always a shame.
Yeah, that's what he was thinking. That's what I was thinking. I said, my man going to get the fondle some of these.
That's the only reason I have this show is to fondle whatever I can. Yeah.
But they made his character gay. And he did a great job. And then he goes into the stand-up part they let him do on the show. And he's bombing. And then he's like, oh, I'm going to talk about my broke boyfriend. And he kills with that material. Because the way they played it was like it was coming from a true place.
Right. Mm.
And that's what comedy is. From what I've been, from my understanding, is you have to come from a true place and it has to mean something to you, or it really isn't gonna play very well. Or somebody can steal it from you and use it, you know, for themselves. If you make
Carlos Mencia.
Exactly.
Yep.
But if you just make stuff up and it doesn't come from a true place, people aren't gonna believe you.
Yeah.
I was also told by somebody when I first started, talk to your audience. If you feel like you're having a conversation with them, they'll receive you better. Like V told me she wanted to go and do DCH open mic. I don't know if she did it or not.
I can't wait to see that.
I don't know if she did it or not.
She's just going to wind up ranting about politics.
Yeah, V the bomb hangover.
Well, she's going to be on our show this coming Thursday.
Nice. Are you going to participate in the Gong show that she's organizing?
Trying to.
Okay.
Nice. Trying to.
Dell's going to do naked stand-up for it.
Yeah. Oh, we had a guy.
I'm literally just going to have it stand up for 8 minutes.
Boom.
And everyone's going to laugh.
And everybody's going to laugh. They're going to gong it.
There was a guy at DCH, Dallas Comedy House, on Tuesday, got up on a stool, stripped down to his pants, and stood there. I saw the video. I wasn't there. I saw the video. I thought he was peeing on stage. But he got up there, and he stood there, and I said, what is this guy doing? And then he just jumps off. What is that? That's not comedy.
Yeah.
That's confusing.
Exactly.
Well, do y'all know who Larry David is?
Yes.
One of the best stories I ever heard of. See, he doesn't like Larry David.
Larry David is great.
I think that's crazy.
No, you Larry, like him. Larry David is awkward.
No, he's
and
hilarious.
That's his genius. That's the genius of Larry David.
Yeah. So good.
I've been awkward my whole life and no one's given me money for it.
Keep working at it.
Yeah, keep working at it. Play it up.
Him. He didn't get that his whole life.
Keep working at it.
But one of the best stories I always heard is Larry David's a horrible stand-up comedian. He just can't seem to deliver jokes right. One of the best stories that Seinfeld tells is that Larry walks out on the stage one time with the microphone, he takes the microphone out, he looks around and nobody's laughing or anything. He's uncomfortable. He just goes, fuck you, you don't deserve this, and just puts the mic back really slowly and walks off stage, and everybody exploded in applause. And that was his stand-up. He just said, all of you suck, you're not going to laugh at my jokes, fuck all of you, and just laugh. Yeah. So,
Just getting out on the stage has got to be the hardest part. I don't think I can do that. So
yeah.
That's what people say. Some people are afraid. Me, I never was afraid. I grew up in a violent background. Not by my parents. My parents were great people, but I grew up in a tough neighborhood. So
raised in the Thunderdome, people.
So walking up on stage and I have the mic and I'm louder than you, mm-hmm. and I'm not afraid of you anyway. Well, so I just got up there and started talking. Yeah. This is what I think, and you're going to hear it. I heard somebody say, I have an opinion. They say, I'm not yelling. I just have an opinion, so I'm talking louder than you so you can hear me.
Yeah.
And that was my take on it when I got up the very first time.
Yeah.
I just went in, and I went 1 week, and I watched the open mic. Saw
how That's probably a good way to start.
I watched how it worked because I didn't want to go up there and be fumbling around because I don't know the rules. I sat down, and I watched. I watched the whole thing till the last comic was done. I saw what people did that didn't work. I saw what people did that did work. And I went back that next week, got on the list, and got up. I had already had my material written. I had been practicing at home. And I just got up and did it. I've watched people get up and have no clue of what they're doing.
Yeah, I've seen a few of those, too.
And it's not that they didn't know what they were doing because they weren't funny. They didn't know the process, so it made it awkward.
Mm-hmm.
And so it took focus off your material and what you were doing. I mean, learn your craft if you're going to do it.
Absolutely.
And they weren't. They just show up. Oh, it's got to be. You just got to act silly.
That's my problem with like 95% of stuff on YouTube is people think, oh, I did something, so it's worth putting out there. And it's like, no. If you're going to do something, it needs to be better than other people. Just because you personally did something doesn't mean it's worth other people taking their time to view.
Exactly.
And you've got to, if you're going to do if you're going to do something, you need to spend the time and the energy to make it as best you can before showing it to people. And too many times, I mean, how many times have we seen stuff on YouTube where it's one guy's like, I made this song for my girlfriend. It's like, well, okay, anybody can write a damn song. I mean, did you take time to make sure it was good? Did you run it by other people? Did you test it before you put it out there?
And most importantly, is she still your girlfriend?
Yeah, that's the...
After that, were you able to keep her?
But I've seen a lot of stand-up comics, especially on open mic nights, where they just... They think that because they're standing up with a mic in their hand saying stuff, that you should laugh.
Yeah.
And I don't get that. You know, it's like getting on stage and just having a guitar and strumming it and thinking people should like your music. Yeah. You know?
This is the thing, though. Chris Layman told me a few months back. Chris, you guys, I don't know if you know Chris Layman.
I don't think so.
He just won this year. He won the best comic in Texas.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. He told me, he said, if you go to an open mic and you kill, you're doing it wrong. Open mic is practice. You go there, you write during the week, and what CJ, who is the host of our show, who's one of my biggest mentors and a great guy, he's constantly telling me, John, a new 5 minutes every week. And I've heard that from other comics also. So you write, and I guarantee you, any comic that you see that's successful writes material. And he practices. You practice at home, and you practice at open mics.
For instance, I saw Chris Rock one time perform with a notepad in his hand.
Yeah.
Then he would do the material and scratch it off if it didn't work. He'd be like, oh, and people would laugh. He'd be like, you guys like that? Well, okay. And then he'd mark it down.
Yeah.
But that was he would do an open mic night, even as Chris Rock, years into his career. And he did it one day here in Dallas at a small little club. And he didn't tell anybody he was going to be there, but he was testing material to see what worked, you know?
You have to practice, just like a drummer, a guitar player, a singer.
Porn artist. Yeah.
Some of my favorite people in the world. Yes. Some of my favorite people in the world. Because without them, I wouldn't know how to do it.
Yeah. They've taught me more than my parents or school ever did about sex.
Nobody else but porn stars taught me where to put it and how to do it.
That's the news that we were going to talk about earlier on in the show.
What was it?
The syphilis outbreak from that porn star.
Oh, yeah.
This porn star was forging his STD screening documents.
Yes.
And just so he could keep working, and he spread syphilis across a lot of porn stars.
But he's not the only one that's done that, I'm sure.
No, but this is like a huge...
Yeah,
because he was working for like two of the biggest porn producers.
Yeah. If I remember correctly, there was one that did it with AIDS also.
Yeah, that was... Yeah. Well, that was an accident. A condom broke during a set in South America, and when they came back, for some reason, the test showed a false negative.
South American condoms. Don't ever buy. But of course, the porn industry is very.
They actually have the lowest amount per capita of STDs because they are very,
very they're
serious.
They're self-regulating because that's their business. They can't, you know, have all their stars dying. Mm-hmm. So
It's like a wood shop just not caring if people chopped off their fingers. You're still going to need that shit to run it through. You know?
So if your
dick falls off, you're not going to be making that much more porn.
Or you'll be making a different.
Or you can be the bottom. Yeah, I was about to say of a gay porn. That's
or you
too.
Just drop dead.
Or just specialty porn.
Yeah, that never helps a
very,
career.
Very
never helps a career. So,
except I'll take it back. Maybe Eddie Murphy's career would be.
Yeah.
If he dropped dead, people might go, that's probably the best move he's made in movies in like 15 years.
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about the show as well.
Well, what we do is we do a round table.
Starstruck, just in case people at home forgot because they're smoking weed at home.
Yeah, Starstruck. We normally do like a round table like this. And we have a lot of guests in. I love it when we have guests in because they bring a different type of perspective and a different type of energy. We had a woman, Mama Michelle, a couple weeks ago who was just hilarious. She's a local female comic. She is hilarious. And she has a wonderful voice. Jedi recorded her for some voiceover stuff.
Very cool.
Her voice is beautiful. We promote everybody's show. If you have something going on, we do our show on Thursday. At the end of the show, we talk about what's going on during the weekend.
Nice.
So let us know what you have going on during the weekend so we can promote it. We talk about what movies are coming out, what comedy events, because we are a comic show. We talk about all comics coming to town. We do bits. We have this one bit called This Moment in Light-Skinned History, which I think Jedi really likes.
That sounds great already.
Where we take actual black history and take some poetic justice with it and add some stuff in.
Nice.
And it works really good. It always works. It works great. CJ writes most of those. Probably all of those. CJ is a great writer.
You know, we're talking about putting together for the station the first non-live show. We're talking about putting together like a little sitcom.
Right,
15 minutes.
Right.
About, well, we won't talk about the premise in case anybody steals it at home, because our viewer audience are bastards.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you can't give them anything. And you know you're fucking bastards. But, but yeah, we should maybe talk to you guys about getting together, because what we need more than anything else is we got ideas, but writers. Yeah, we need more writers.
We write every week. Comics, we write every week.
Right.
And Patrick does a lot of voices. Patrick Puckett, the only white guy on the show, but I call him my light-skinned brother. Hey, we got to get it in where it fit in. But Patrick does, he does the traffic. He does the traffic. Patrick does the traffic and the news. And he does a lot of other stuff. He writes really good stuff. And he does voices. He has this Dominican baseball player voice that if you turn the camera off, you would think there was a Dominican baseball player in his studio. He does great voices. And he is really funny. He lived in L.A. for a while. And then he moved back to Dallas about a year and a half ago, I think. And that's another thing comics do. They perfect their craft. And then they move to another market to try to grow. That's what you have to do. Yeah. If you've outgrown the Dallas-Fort Worth scene, you got to move on.
Mm-hmm.
Just like
just anything else that's maybe creative, anything like with else. Modeling or with being like a musician and
right,
stuff like that.
Right. Because you can't. I don't think you can build a modeling career in Dallas.
This is pretty much where modeling careers go to die.
Yeah. I don't think you can. It's better than say Wichita Falls, Texas.
Yeah. Or Oklahoma.
Yeah, Tulsa,
or Kansas.
Oklahoma.
Yeah. I don't even need to name a city. That whole fucking state. I had to live there for a year.
Oh,
and
yeah.
That was
by the
worst.
Way, Oklahoma. Fuck you.
Yeah, seriously. I don't care. If you're at home watching from Oklahoma, turn it. Don't even. I don't want you watching.
I have to disagree with that. They have comedy clubs and they book us.
Okay, well,
that's different.
Anybody that gives you money is okay.
Yeah, they book us.
That's the difference.
Yeah. There was a CJ did 5 days. 4 days? 4 days in Tulsa a few weeks ago.
Nice.
Yeah, and like I said, you have to travel.
Mm-hmm.
But other things we do on the show, we do bits. We have a Dr. Damus bit. Damus Smith, who's the rudest guy on the show, he has the biggest vocabulary for his background. And I stole that from somebody else. Somebody else told him, said, from your background, you have a huge vocabulary. He will auto-correct anybody speaking. If you say something wrong, he's over there whispering, oh, that's not the way that goes. You need to say this.
And then
he looks away and does that. He doesn't say it to your face.
Nice.
And you're like, what'd you say? Nothing. He's our human auto-corrector.
Nice. I also call those grammar Nazis.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good one. He is a grammar Nazi.
Have you ever, I got to ask real fast, just because, have you ever seen the clip on YouTube? You'll pull this up too. It's Grammar Nazi Hitler. And they took a scene from a really serious drama about Hitler,
mm-hmm.
and they subtitle it with him correcting people's speak. So he's just as violent, just like this. And he's like, there is not an R. There should be a period, not a comma. And as he's screaming, he's correcting speech at the bottom.
Nice.
And man, I giggled all the way through that. That was so great.
I love those YouTubes like that. We play videos. We play YouTube videos. Like, we'll have the video of the week. We'll find something real funny. We don't do it every week, but we throw those in there. My favorite one is the panda noodles or something like that. I can't remember. It's been
so
long.
Oodles and oodles and noodles?
No,
that's noodles on my back.
Noodles
one
on
of the greatest.
Back.
Can I get a high five on that one?
No, it's a panda who sells food in another country. And he walks around and bullies people into buying his product. If you're in the grocery store shopping with the shopping cart and you don't have it, he'll walk up and slam your cart over and kick it. And some comics in America subtitled it, and they did voiceover on it. I'm sorry, did voiceover on it, and they're cussing people out. It is the funniest thing.
All right,
you guys got to
look that up.
You guys got to look that up. You got to find a version where the guy is talking for the panda. There's different versions of it, but you have to find the one where the guy is cussing people out. Told some guy was in a bed, just had surgery. He walked in and unplugged his IV. And told him to die. It's hilarious. Right, you gotta look it up.
So who's on the show this week? Do you have any special guests on this Thursday?
Yeah, we have V, and we're
from Hungover with V.
Hungover with V. She's going to be the female on the show. We want a woman's perspective. We're going to try to add more women guests, not just particularly women comics. We want a woman's point of view. And V was the first person I thought about after meeting her the other day. She's fun, has a great personality. likes to laugh and laugh at herself. So she's going to have a good time. And I want to have...
Just make sure you have the mute button ready occasionally. Why? If anybody else wants to talk on the show.
Oh.
Yeah.
I mean, I love that girl. She's a sweetheart. She co-hosts our show a lot, too. Uh-huh. But yeah, have that mute button ready pretty quick if you need it.
She's going to be sitting next to Damus. Damus will take care
of... your neck.
I'm telling you.
She's sweet.
She will be sitting next to Damus. Damus will take care of that.
Yeah, all right. I may come in just to watch that. Yeah. I'll sit in the audience.
She's going
to
be looking at Damus like... I love Damus. He is hilarious. He will shut anybody down.
I'm excited. All right. So definitely make sure you check out Starstruck this Thursday. What time?
6:30 to 8.
Very nice. Very nice. All right. Well, I'm watching for sure. Well, David, we're going to take a quick break. Then we're going to come back and we're going to bullshit for 5 more minutes. And that's the end of the show. You can go back to doing whatever you're doing with your day. So, John, I want to say thanks for coming in.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Today. Man, it was a lot of fun. So
Yes.
Starstruck Thursdays.
Yeah, Starstruck Thursdays.
I like it.
And Taffeta, we'd like to have you on the show. But you're going to have to wear your Chun-Li outfit.
You have a Chun-Li outfit?
I don't have a Chun-Li outfit.
But you can pull it off. No doubt about it.
Maybe. I'm sure I could find some sort of bustier.
That'll work too.
All right. Well, I'll tell you what. We're going to take a quick break, and then we're going to come back and say our goodbyes. And we'll say once again, Starstruck, 6:30 this Saturday. And
Thursday.
Thursday. I'm sorry. Saturday. What's
wrong with you?
All days of the week
worst
look alike to me.
Ever.
So, but John, thanks for coming in.
Thanks for having me.
You want to stick around for the end of the show?
I am.
Perfect. I appreciate that. All right. See you again, guys. right, guys, we're back, and we just want to say thanks for watching the show today.
Thanks for watching.
I'm gonna go backwards instead of teasing out what we did. I'm gonna tease back for the people that are just tuning in for some stupid reason at the end of the show. So make sure you go back and watch this. We'll pull all the clips and put them online on the YouTube, and you can watch it.
It's so ridiculous.
Her laugh gets me going. Here's the thing about Taff. If you hang out with her a little bit more, you'll notice this. You can walk into a club of 300 people, and you'll hear way across the room, and I can tell where Taff is anywhere in the building. So, well, thanks for watching the show today. Obviously, you can check out if you missed anything. You can go back and watch this again, or you can go onto the YouTube and watch it and stuff like that. The Facey Bookie. Everything's Stop. Funny. I'm wearing flippy floppies. I like my porky choppies. Everything's funnier when you add the easy to the end.
Obviously.
Right. Obviously.
Just the one person, though.
I believe that's what World War II was fought over, and I believe we proved our point with that.
Yeah.
So dropping the bomby wommies.
Yeah, with our gunny wannies.
The bomby wommies.
Yeah. So, thanks for tuning in today. I believe we're going to end on the acapella Ninja Turtles theme. But once again, I want to say, John, thanks for stopping in. Make sure you catch Starstruck on Thursday, 6:30.
Exactly.
On this network here, right here on DPL this one. On this network. DPLE on me.
Dece Network.
No, that didn't work out too well.
DPLE on
me. That's what I was trying to fit it in.
Now we sound like a bunch of reject Flanderses.
Flanderies.
Flanderses.
All right, well, if we're going to end on a high note, it can't be that. So yeah, does anybody got any kind of good joke we can go on if we're going to end on a high note here?
No, that's it.
All right, well, let's end on that then.
I have nothing but bad jokes, so no.
Okay, well, let's end on that down note then. Thanks for watching the show.
All right, thank you, everyone.
Where do we wave?
Does it up or down? I'm going to wave
there,
both.
I think, or, yeah,
there you go.
There.
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles,
heroes in a half shell,
turtle power.
They're the world's most fearsome fighting team.
We're really hip.
They're heroes in the half shell, and they're green.
Hey, get rid of
them. When the evil Shredder attacks, these turtle boys don't cut them no slack.
Turtles,
Splinter taught them to be ninja teams.
He's a radical wreck.
Leonardo leads, Donatello does machines.
That's a fact.
Raphael is cool but rude. Michelangelo is a party dude.
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles,
heroes in a half shell,
turtle power.